Welcome to Our World Today, a progressive political show imagining a better tomorrow. I'm Nancy Brown, sitting in for Suzanne Linton, and tonight our show is with Dave Bicking and Jeff Nygaard, here to talk again about the media.
Yeah, I'm glad to be back. As viewers may remember, I was gone last month because of a family emergency, mostly over, but it had to do with a nursing home and crisis, and anybody who's has aging, ailing parents knows what I'm talking about. But that I'm glad to be back, and I thought I'm going to try and experiment. We sometimes have news shorts or headlines at the beginning of the show, and I thought this month, since I'm a writer after all, I would write down the news shorts and just read them, and so it'll be a little more flowing, perhaps, than
professional. Yeah, I mean, just like
the big kids. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. And these aren't. I want to just do a little caveat. I selected these particular four issues not necessarily because they are headlines in the traditional sense, but because they reveal something. They should be headlines, I think, is maybe what I would say. So one is about the empire. And when U.S. leaders start talking about war, as currently we hear talk of a new Cold War, it's always good to turn to the business pages to get a hint of what is really going on. On the front page of the business section of the March 28th New York Times was a revealing, if confusing, story headlined, "Crackdown on Russia Could Hurt Western Oil." It began, quote, "As the United States seeks to strengthen sanctions on Moscow for its occupation of Crimea, energy experts say the powerful Russian oil industry would make a robust target. But any penalties on energy investments, technology transfers, and financial transactions would most likely also punish Western oil companies, like ExxonMobil, that are investing heavily in Russia," unquote. Regular viewers will recall Dave Bicking pointing out on last month's Our World Today that U.S. Assistant Secretary of State for European and Eurasian Affairs Victoria Nuland addressed the U.S.-Ukraine Foundation in December, speaking from a stage that was adorned with the logos of ExxonMobil and Chevron. So we know what they're talking about the links here. The Times continues, quote, "As the heart of the Russian economy, the energy sector, led by state oil companies like Gazprom, Lukoil, and Rosneft, would be a natural focus for pressure from the United States and its allies. Oil and petroleum products represent more than two-thirds of Russian export earnings, and they finance just over half of the federal budget. But the rub is that the interests of the Russian companies, many led by powerful allies of President Vladimir V. Putin, are increasingly entwined with those of American and European corporations with which they share critical projects," unquote. At the end of the article, we get a hint of what might really be going on here, although it's not stated very clearly. "So far," says the Times, "Congress has increasingly pressed the Obama administration to quicken the pace of approvals for natural gas export terminals, with the aim of easing European dependence on Russian gas," unquote. Is that really the aim of these giant energy corporations, to ease European stress? Today's USA Today reports that, quote, "The export gas rush is on. From the Pacific Northwest to the Mid-Atlantic to the Gulf states, companies are moving forward with plans to export U.S. natural gas despite controversy over the impact on prices and pollution," unquote. The sentiment is echoed by the business publication Kiplinger Personal Finance. Appearing the same day as the USA Today article, which is actually today, April 7th, we read, quote, "Lessening Europe's reliance on Russian natural gas by boosting global supplies of liquefied natural gas and creating alternative supply options is what this is really all about," quote unquote, says energy analyst Phil Flynn of brokerage firm Price Futures Group. "Russia is, quote, desperate to hang on to its share of the European energy market," he says. "Europe currently relies on Russia for one-third of its gas needs, according to data from the International Energy Agency," unquote. What this is really all about is not, of course, making it easier for Europeans. It's about squeezing out Russia and grabbing more market share for newly fracked natural gas from the U.S. As always, follow the money. Another story I want to highlight is the demise of the Grand Bargain. If people remember, the Grand Bargain was the big deal where Democrats and Republicans were going to come together to agree to have a little bit more in taxes if we can just cut those darn entitlement programs, which are causing all the problems. So amidst all the confused reporting on recently proposed federal budgets was a major piece of good news, a people's victory on a major issue of concern to all of us, Social Security. One wouldn't know it was a major victory since it only appeared on the inside pages of the nation's newspapers, but some of the basic facts were reported. when it comes to Social Security, I think the best summary comes from a piece I found a couple of days ago in, of all places, Insurance News Net, a trade publication of the insurance industry. Sure, I read it. The original story appeared in the magazine These Times a month ago with the headline, How Social Security Was Saved. Here are the first few paragraphs. Progressive groups and their allies in Congress win one for the people. The release of the White House's 2014 budget in April 2013 was a stomach-churning occasion for American seniors who depend on Social Security. In an effort to woo the austerity now crowd, President Barack Obama included in last year's proposal a new formula to calculate Social Security cost of living adjustments, the chained consumer price index, or chained CPI. Presented as a harmless technocratic fix, chained CPI would have hit America's retirees in the pocketbook by reducing their Social Security cost of living increases. At the time, much of Washington was fixated on the grand bargain, a long-term bipartisan budget deal. To centrist Democrats, chained CPI seemed like the ideal bargaining chip to nudge Republicans into accepting modest tax increases on the wealthy. This year, Obama's 2015 budget includes no mention of chained CPI, a victory that can be attributed to progressive organizers working inside and outside the halls of Congress. In fact, what has been for years a fundamentally defensive fight has now evolved into an offensive one, including the introduction by Senator Tom Harkin of the Strengthening Social Security Act of 2013, reintroduced this year, which would change the method by which Social Security calculates Social Security benefits, boosting benefits for all beneficiaries by $70 per month on average, adjust the cost of living adjustment by using the consumer price index for the elderly, which is an index that more accurately calculates inflation for elderly people receiving Social Security, and would phase out the current taxable cap of $113,700 so that payroll taxes apply fairly to every dollar of wages. The demise of the grand bargain and the growing power of grassroots progressivism is a people's victory and should be on front pages everywhere. Now, that's my second story. My third story is it was a local story buried on the in the business section, this time in the Star Tribune, newspaper of the Twin Cities based in Minneapolis. The business section had a story headlined, Minnesota Regulators to Study Power Sector Pollution Costs. The story has been going on for a while, but the story in the December 19th strip, Star Tribune, told of an increasing momentum toward an official acknowledgement that the market doesn't accurately calculate the real costs of energy production. This move away from a market analysis and towards a system analysis could be a game changer. The Strib reported, quote, Minnesota utility regulators on Thursday agreed to take a fresh look at whether the price of pollution is accurately reflected in the cost of electrical generating plants. The 4-1 vote by the State Public Utilities Commission sets in motion a lengthy and technical process to better calculate the social cost of smokestack emissions linked to climate change and human illnesses. The PUC, Public Utilities Commission, regulates, for people who don't know, regulates Minnesota's electricity, natural gas, and telephone industries, which for reasons we won't go into, are in the hands of private corporations. The PUC's, quote, mission is to create and maintain a regulatory environment that ensures safe, reliable, and efficient utility services at fair and reasonable rates, according to the Minnesota law. The Strip continues, quote, the outcome could have significant consequences for the power-generating industry, improving the economics of cleaner energy sources like wind and solar versus coal-fired powered plant, not to mention nuclear. Republican PUC Commissioner Betsy Wergen opposed the study, saying it could drive up utility prices. We are completely ignoring the ratepayer, she said. Adds the Strib, the emissions to be studied include carbon dioxide, which is linked to climate change, and those that affect health, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, and small airborne particles, unquote. This is important since ratepayers are also human beings, about whose health the market cares not. Exactly what will happen with this is not clear, as the energy industry has a history of getting away with slipshod safety practices. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission last year cited Xcel Energy for inadequate catastrophic flood planning at the nuclear power plant, for example. But in the wake of the Japanese nuclear disaster 3 years ago and the growing awareness of the ecological effects of carbon-based energy production, popular resistance is growing, as the recent PUC decision shows. And my last headline is kind of a follow-up to last month's talk about Ukraine. It's still going on, of course, but last month we talked about it on this show. Oh, you did. I wasn't here.
Yeah.
Whether it's a new Cold War or not, someone wants us to be afraid of Russia. On April 2nd, the New York Times ran a lengthy article headlined, In Crimea, Russia showcases a rebooted army. The article speaks of, quote, a sweeping modernization effort undertaken 5 years ago by Vladimir Putin that has revitalized Russia's conventional military abilities, frightening some of its former vassal states in Eastern Europe. The transformation of the armed forces has been a personal priority of Mr. Putin, we're told, who as prime minister from 2009 to 2012, and more recently in his return to the presidency, has overseen billions of dollars in new military expenditures. The military was one of the few areas of the Russian budget to receive big spending increases. The spectacular rise in military spending is expected to increase to about $100 billion in 2016 from about $80 billion this year, even as the economy shows signs of recession, unquote. An increase to $100 billion. Unreported in the Times story is the fact that the U.S. spends between $550 and $965 billion on the military, 5 to 10 times the Russian budget, depending on how you define military, and more than the next 13 nations of the world combined. Russia ranks third behind China. The Times worries that, quote, as commander-in-chief, Mr. Putin has also presided over unprecedented training exercises, including what the Kremlin billed as the largest peacetime mobilization ever, about 160,000 troops, officials said, in Russia's Far East in the summer of 2013, and an array of drills in Western Russia, to prepare for potential threats along the borders with Europe and the Caucasus, unquote. As usual, any preparation for threats translates in the U.S. media as aggression. On the same page of that day's New York Times was an article by Michael Gordon, known for his pro-war reporting in regard to Iraq and Afghanistan. The article was headlined, NATO Commander Says He Sees Potent Threat from Russia. In it, we learn of NATO's plans for strengthening NATO's air, sea, and land abilities on Russia's borders. We need to go to the London Guardian, however, to learn that the day before, quote, a NATO committee had drafted plans, quote, for promoting stability in Eastern Europe in the current context by increasing military cooperation with Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Moldova, all in Russia's near abroad and considered by Moscow as falling within its sphere of influence. A confidential 7-page paper leaked to the German newsweekly Der Spiegel proposed joint exercises and training between NATO and the three countries, increasing the interoperability of their militaries with NATO and their participation in NATO smart defense. Meanwhile, the Times' Gordon reports that the NATO commander, quote, said that he planned to present options along with his own recommendations for strengthening NATO's air, sea, and land abilities to defend Russia's neighbors without being provocative, unquote. This would be analogous to a Russian-dominated military alliance, there is none, planning exercises in Mexico, Costa Rica, and Cuba. And that story of the uproar over Russia's activities in and around Ukraine goes on with the narrative seeming to evolve into this idea of a new Cold War, right, where the United States' concern, as always, only for the welfare of the Ukrainian people, is setting up, ringing all kinds of military options from sea to shining sea around this. Well, actually, there's no sea on the east.
Black Sea.
And it's all Soviet responses portrayed as aggression.
Right. Yeah. We covered a fair amount of this last month with some historical background on Crimea and things. Not as much has happened in this month. It's more of a standoff at this point. But it's still a rather dangerous standoff. And I think it's important to put some of this into perspective, as you were doing with that story, that, yes, there is, I think, probably an increasing concentration of Russian military in that area, though the news, I've seen other accounts that say, well, there's no real backup or actual evidence for this, and we've been told this kind of thing before. But nevertheless, even the kind of hysterical reporting of Russia is massing troops on the border. First of all, we have to keep in mind that you could say that as Russia is massing troops inside Russia.
Right.
This is their border, after all. But also in the number of troops that are claimed that are there is 40,000. I've heard that seems to be the number we're supposed to be scared of. And somebody put it in good context, just before the United States invaded Iraq in 2003, we had massed 150,000 troops on the borders of Iraq. And no, that was not actually inside the United States.
Right.
So the these things, claims have to be taken with a grain of salt, both in terms of their magnitude, but also whether they're even valid. People with long memories and who actually heard this at the beginning of the first Iraq War, when, if you recall, in 1991, Iraq invaded Kuwait, and that was the reason why we had to push them out of Kuwait and then, you know, continue bombing for the next 10 years and various sanctions. At that time, it was very difficult for the United States to get Saudi Arabia to go along because the United States needed to get troops into Saudi Arabia to stage for that war there. And Saudi Arabia, though an ally of ours, had traditionally not allowed, you know, 100,000 heavily armed infidels to operate off of their territory. And so we're very resistant to that. And the United States put forward a story that the Iraqi army, having invaded Kuwait, which they considered to be their 19th province, whatever, you know, I'm not justifying any invasion there, but there was reasons to think that that was their sole goal, was to invade Kuwait and not continue to move south into the deserts of Saudi Arabia. But so to convince Saudi Arabia to allow our troops to be based there in their holy territory, the United States claimed that there was a huge buildup of Iraqi troops just south of Kuwait on the Saudi Arabian border. Tanks, all sorts of things. An enterprising reporter, just one individual, working for the St. Petersburg Times, of all things. It's not, you know, the Associated Press of the New York Times, but she filed a Freedom of Information Act request.
St. Petersburg, Florida, not St.
St. Petersburg, Florida. Soviet. Right, right, yes, right, not that St. Petersburg, yes. Filed a information request to get satellite images from that area. And sure enough, there was nothing on those images. No troops, no tanks. And as she said, you know, tank tracks in that area remain for years after they pass because of the terrain. Nothing. No sign that it was there or it had been there. A little bit of enterprising reporting that didn't get reported very far. But that gives you, makes you wonder about the accuracy of anything we're told since then, particularly since after she reported on that, those satellite images are no longer available to anybody in the media.
On a related note, since you bring up Saudi Arabia, almost unnoticed was Barack Obama's stop in Riyadh about 2 weeks ago, just overnight, reassuring the monarchy that the House of Saud, that which is, by the way, I believe the largest purchaser of foreign of arms from the U.S. of any country in the world, I think, and the relationship with the Saudi Arabia on the part of the United States is not unrelated to the rise of Al Qaeda and Osama bin Laden's influence, because of, like you said, the presence of infidel troops on holy land, which is what a lot of people, well, in Islam. Saudi Arabia has a lot of sacred sites. So it's a very complicated thing, and I think the little overnight stop and meeting that Obama had with the King Abdullah was worth saying something about. It got very few paragraphs in the media, but a very important relationship that doesn't get reported much.
Right, and if you recall, Osama bin Laden was from Saudi Arabia, and one of his prime grievances was the presence of U.S. troops in Saudi Arabia, which we got there, but through devious means, for the build-up to the first Iraq War. So these things do tie together. Right. Another thing that ties together very much in all this is what you mentioned about the, you know, gas coming from the Soviet Union. Ukraine is one of the main places where it comes through to reach Europe. And so there's a lot of pipelines in Ukraine. And you mentioned also liquefied natural gas. Well, Europe would much rather be supplied by Russia for security because oil travels fairly well on tankers. Natural gas, however, being a gas, is not that easy to transport. And to understand some of the goings on with natural gas and the politics and economics of that, you have to realize it has to be liquefied at extremely low temperatures.
About 260 degrees below zero.
Yes, and put on tankers and held at that temperature all the way across the ocean. This is not the best way to move natural gas.
Right.
And that has affected, you know, political things before in terms of where the United States gets its natural gas, why we import so little natural gas relative to oil, which we're now, you know, exporting more of. But, of course, the fracking boom provides the United States with actually excess natural gas. The natural gas companies are not so thrilled that the prices have actually come down a bit because of the huge supply, because of the fracking. So this is a chance for the United States to get some influence and dependence by Europe on the United States rather than dependence on Russia, and particularly dependence on the pipelines coming through the Ukraine. So that's a major thing. But as you say, also, it can backfire because Russia also has some economic influence through all these things. The Europeans are less inclined to engage in some adventure, which might mean the cutoff of their natural gas, first of all. But also, it's important that these sanctions that we talk about or hear about, you know, that I don't think people understand entirely what it's all about, because one of the sanctions is to freeze assets. Mm-hmm. Now, that's another name for theft. If the bank suddenly froze your assets, I mean, oh yeah, you still have them, but you can't withdraw them from the bank for the indefinite future. We'd consider that, you know, stealing. Right. Or it's the sort of thing that would cause a run on the banks. Or a sort of thing that if Russia or similar countries see this coming, withdraw their money very wisely from U.S. financial institutions, which you'd think there'd be more of a pushback from U.S. banks not to do this kind of thing. So a lot of these things can backfire. Mm. So there's a lot of economics at work there, and it's very good you look at the economics section to understand far more about these wars.
Well, and also the you connect a couple of stories. One was that little story in the about the PUC looking at social costs of energy production. Yeah. I give tremendous credit to environmental activists who've done the legwork to bring that on to the table, because the PUC didn't just do it.
No,
you know, it's
and
always
it's
activists
tedious
make,
working
it's,
with them. Yes.
Yeah, and activists have to be out there camping out, marching, writing petitions, letters, testifying, doing all the legwork that activists have to do to just get these people to sit up and take notice, let alone vote 4-1 to start looking at social costs. But if we were doing that on a national level, then the whole issue of competing for European markets for gas using liquefied natural gas, which is acquired through fracking, would be a whole different discussion, because the nature, as we know, I think, the nature of a corporate business environment is one of the tactics for success is to externalize as many costs as possible. That is, a corporation will take things, for example, cleanup of their pollution, which logically and ethically is a part of doing business. But if the market can somehow... Yeah. The word externalize in economic terms means that the enterprise that produces the cost does not pay it. So you produce a toxic field, and suddenly it's a Superfund site where taxpayers are paying for it rather than ExxonMobil or whoever. And if that were the calculation, that's why I think the idea of paying attention and front-paging stories like the PUC decision and the implications of it then can build momentum. And we in the alternative press need to do that, which is part of why I'm doing this, to front page of this thing, so people all in other states next door to Minnesota or anywhere say, you know what? What's our Public Utilities Commission doing? How come we're not looking at the social cost? Right. And wait a minute, how about that pipeline coming through here? And do we really want to compete with Russia on these terms? You know, so this it's all a kind of a gestalt. I love that word. to really where we look at the not just the what the market tells us. And I think that's what activists, as we build our own media and try to get our voices heard in the media, is to continue to make the picture bigger and bigger, so we can see that it's not everything the market tells us is not everything we need to be told. You know. So, speaking of which, another story I wanted to mention related to this, although related in this way, if you look at the press that I was talking about with the Russian military threat, but also just the front paging of the entire situation in Ukraine, where there's a identified threat, the leader of Russia, Putin, is portrayed as being deranged or out of touch with reality on another planet. Yeah. No, in another world is what the Secretary of State said. That kind of threat reminds me of the threat after the newspaper coverage after 9/11, where for months and months there were special sections, and every headline was about the danger, the threat, the fear of terror. But here's a story that isn't getting front page like that, even despite massive evidence that it's a bigger threat, which is climate change. And on March 18th, there was a report that came out from the AAAS, which is the
American Academy for the Advancement of Science.
Thank you, Dave. And the report was called What We Know, The Reality, Risks, and Response to Climate Change. And the AAAS, for people who haven't heard of it, has affiliates, 258 societies and academies of science, more than 10 million members. It's the world's largest federation of scientific and engineering societies. And this report, What We Know, is a 28-page report. It's not long. But it's part of an initiative that the AAAS has undertaken, not to do new research or to uncover new reporting or anything like that, simply to take a responsibility as scientists to say, this is what, well, that's why it's called, What We Know, to say that, to press, put political pressure, really, and pressure through the media on policymakers to say, you know, this really is a front page story. This is a threat. We need to be doing something. When the report came out on March 18th, I found two mentions in the corporate media. One was actually in the science section of the New York Times on the day before. They had a leaked copy of the report, I won't go into that. The second report I saw was on page 2 of the Los Angeles Times, 600 words, pretty superficial, and that's it. Nothing on National Public Radio, nothing on the TV networks. So I want to highlight a couple of things from the report that I thought were particularly interesting. These are just straight excerpts from the report. Page 4, surveys show that many Americans think climate change is still a topic of significant scientific disagreement. Thus, it is important and increasingly urgent for the public to know there is now a high degree of agreement among climate scientists that human-caused climate change is real. Moreover, while the public is becoming aware that climate change is increasing the likelihood of certain local disasters, many people do not yet understand that there is a small but real chance of abrupt, unpredictable, and potentially irreversible changes with highly damaging impacts on people in the United States and around the world. And they stress that about 97% of climate scientists have concluded that human-caused climate change is happening, and we are at risk of pushing our climate system toward those abrupt, unpredictable, and potentially irreversible changes. They stress also that the sooner we act, the lower the risk and cost. There's much we can do, and they have a whole section of recommendation for policymakers. But I want to highlight a couple things. One thing they say is, as scientists, it is not our role to tell people what they should do or must believe about the rising threat of climate change. But we consider it to be our responsibility as professionals to ensure, to the best of our ability, that people understand what we know. And again, human-caused climate change is happening. We face risks of abrupt, unpredictable, and potentially irreversible changes, and responding now will lower the risk and cost of taking action. In terms of media, there's a couple highlighted points for me. One is that, this one, research shows that Americans who think the scientific experts disagree about human-caused climate change are less likely to believe that it might have serious consequences. Failure to appreciate the scientific consensus reduces support for a broad societal response to the challenges and risks that climate change represents. So, and I think that's a crucial point for people working in media or concerned with media. It's not just that people should know. It's that when people are misinformed or unaware of some basic facts about real threats, and this is, here I'm editorializing, way more of a threat to each and every one of us than Russia could ever be, you know, short of nuclear war.
Right.
And we're not talking about nuclear war in Ukraine. So the idea that the lack of information or a distortion of information, which comes to us, after all, primarily through media, even in the face of repeated scientific reports and statements and press releases and warnings over the years, this one only being the most recent, it has effects on the political reality, the political context in which the United States operates domestically in terms of regulation and energy policy, but also in our behavior in international fora and actions like that.
And of course, that's exactly how it was intended when those talking points were introduced to the media by the corporations that had an interest in not having a consensus to go forward.
Absolutely.
So this has finally shown up and kind of come home to roost.
And this is a basic principle of, to digress a second, a basic principle of public relations theory, which is that all you need to do to prevent people from taking action is not to refute their motivation or the point that might motivate them to take action, but to cast doubt on it. If people are just a little unsure, then no matter how serious it is, well, in fact, the more serious it is, a little uncertainty will say, well, that's a big change, I'm not sure.
Right.
And it stops everything there.
Or I'm not going to do something that's wrong or something that's going to hurt things. It takes a lot of motivation for people to get out and actually act on anything. And even the smallest doubts have a huge effect that way. Or you can just say, oh, well, I want to learn more about it until then and all that. I know some groups of people have talked about paralysis by analysis.
Yep.
Yeah, let's do another study here
and they'd love
before
that.
We do anything.
The corporate interest would love paralysis.
Send it to a committee.
Send it to a committee, yes. So.
Well, the good news is, I think, well, I'm just going to read six of the things they talk about as possible outcomes. Some of the impacts of climate change that are already occurring and will increase over the coming years. And I'm sure this isn't news to many of our viewers, but it's worth repeating, I think. Arctic sea ice has been shrinking dramatically. The melting of the Greenland and Antarctica ice sheets has also accelerated notably. The oceans are rapidly acidifying, with early impacts on shelled organisms such as oysters already documented. The current acidification rate is likely the fastest in 300 million years. Extinctions of all species are likely to increase. Sea level rise has also accelerated. Global warming has changed the pattern of precipitation worldwide, bringing increasing heat waves, floods, and drought. Climate change has amplified the threat of wildfires, and climate disruption is already affecting human health and well-being in many ways, and health threats are expected to intensify. On a little bit of a good note, a postscript is, even though the papers mostly did not cover that particular report, there was a story in the New York Times from March 29th on the front page about Bangladesh and climate change. And I'll just read a couple of sentences from that report. The Bangladeshi climate scientists and politicians have come to agree that by 2050, 26 years from now, is that right? 36 years from now, rising sea levels will inundate some 17% of Bangladesh and displace about 18 million people. Tariq Karim, Bangladesh's ambassador to India, says, "We need a regional and better yet a global solution. And if we don't get one soon, the Bangladeshi people will soon become the world's problem because we will not be able to keep them." Mr. Karim estimated that as many as 50 million Bangladeshis would flee the country by 2050 if sea levels rose as expected. So other reports have talked about the, in fact, the National Security Agency has done a report, which I've talked about in Nygaard Notes, nygaardnotes.org, my newsletter, where they talk about the specifically the security threats posed by climate change, which should seem obvious. As resources become more scarce, there's going to be more struggles to control them or to just get them. Water being the most immediate one, I think. There's a huge drought in California, which is worse in other parts. Well, I don't know if it's worse, but serious droughts and the poverty laid on top of drought causes enormous suffering all over the place. The climate change has meant that precipitation patterns are more extreme. So like the Northeast United States and Europe lately has been far more wet than ever, from decades anyway. And drier places like Southwestern United States is far drier than it has been for many years. So these are the kind of things that I just want to point out for media activists, that the degree and immediacy of the threat of climate change is such that we should be seeing special sections, like we did after 9/11, special sections, headlines. Yeah. It should be an issue in every campaign. What are you going to do about this? And it isn't there's more coverage, I think, than there has been. But as evidenced by the lack of coverage of the AAAS report, what we know, the reality, risks, and response to climate change. And today, as we put the show out, April 7th is the beginning of the next session of the International Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. The IPCC is meeting, starting today, and it'll be meeting for all week, I think. And we'll see what kind of coverage, and hopefully we'll talk about that next month.
Don't you think, though, that the reason that the coverage hasn't happened on this is because the media looked at that and said, there's nothing new here. The polar ice caps, you know, all these things, now we're getting used to them, and we've sort of adjusted to them, and they're looking for something new. You know, true. And Obama was covered because he just, like, doubled or something, and don't quote me on that. He dramatically increased the amount of money that they're putting into fighting wildfires, right, because they've had to take money from all these other places because of climate change, right, caused wildfires. Right. So they're covering these adaptations. But the fundamental story, again, is part of the background now, and it's nothing new. So I think the challenge for activists and media activists is to figure out ways to get climate change into a newsworthy place, to create stories around it.
Right. It's a slow-moving story.
Right.
And that's the media has a lot of trouble with those, regardless of what the topic may be.
Right. No matter how potentially damaging or catastrophic there, if it's slow-moving and there's no new news.
But it's widely acknowledged at this point. I mean, the U.S. military acknowledges climate change as maybe the most important threat, and certainly one of the most important threats, and yet that acknowledgement doesn't get into our newspapers like the threat of, you know, Russian troops massing on their own border. But, you know, in the insurance industry, again, if you read things, you quoted from something you read in what was that?
The insurance industry, trade companies.
I mean, they certainly are recognizing climate change because it has a major impact on their level of risk. And so this is where you find out some of these
things. In fact, there was a special on Channel 2 in Twin Cities just last night, Sunday night, April 6th, which might replay. And it was a half-hour show, and it was basically a speech by the head of, I think it's the Insurance Federation of Minnesota, talking about climate change and its effect on insurance policies in Minnesota. That the risk of floods is greater, the risk of this and that and everything else is greater. Not just the risk, but the payouts have been much higher, especially in floods. So, the insurance industry is highly aware of this. And I think, Nancy, you're exactly right that partly it's a slow-moving story. There's no man bites dog here, so it doesn't jump out at you. It's not photogenic. I mean, it actually is if you want to take pictures of wildfires and floods. Right. But I think there's two other factors, though, that keep it out of the media that conspire along with that, which is one is that the degree of, intensity of action that would be needed to address this is such that people in positions of power don't want to talk about it because nobody wants to hear it.
Right.
And I think that's the other thing is that so the sources they're going to, which are increasingly more and more media use powerful insider sources. They don't want to talk about this. It's not a new story, like you said. And also, it's bad. It's a downer. It's not the kind of thing that gets people to, I want to watch that. You know, they'd rather see a story about the wildfire itself. That's pretty dramatic. You see the flames. Right. You see, you know, and that's, so I think the combination of it being an ongoing story that doesn't present a hook, a news hook, the fact that it requires a great response, which puts responsibility on the viewer, which viewers don't tend to want, and the fact that it's just not something people want to hear about, doesn't mean good ratings. So it's sort of set up, like you said, it's up to activists to figure out how can we get this not in people's faces like beat on them with it, but to really get people to see the severity of the issue. So rather than spending our billions on the Department of Homeland Security, much of which, in my mind, is money ill spent, let's put it politely, diverts some of that money to real serious moving away from a carbon-based economy.
It's the solutions I think we're missing, because I think people are kind of getting the severity,
yep,
but they're not hearing that there's an opportunity for meaningful solutions.
Exactly.
And it's interesting to think about the Putin comparison, because there's none of that get-your-blood-boiling kind of fervor around it, which there could be. I mean, my husband once said if an alien invasion would be what it takes to unite the Earth, the people of Earth. There has to be something immediate and threatening. This is maybe threatening over a longer term, but how is it we can, you know, the media are so eager to create that sense of threat around, a military threat or a threat from another nation, mm-hmm. or perceived or real or not.
Right. Yeah.
But they aren't willing to go there or to create mm-hmm. that same sense
right.
of threat. I mean.
Right.
And you've also got the thing, we talk about, profits that are internalized and externalized costs and stuff. Mm-hmm. There are costs which are immediate, costs which are long-term, or solutions yeah. that are long-term versus immediate profits to keep doing what we're doing there. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
So there's immediate benefits for the people who are fracking and transporting oil and gouging out the tar sands and all that kind of stuff.
Well,
or something that... for a long time it was, well, maybe that'll affect us down the road. But
right.
even when we know for sure it'll yeah. affect us down the road, it doesn't have the immediacy of the next quarterly report.
And I think people feel like, well, I'm culpable. I drive a car. Therefore, there's probably nothing we can do because none of us are going to give up our cars.
Right.
But we haven't really been able to have the conversation about that. There is something we could do collectively.
Right. Right.
And it doesn't mean all of us have to radically change
right.
our lifestyles.
Mm-hmm.
But there are positive solutions, which I think
right.
people don't really realize.
Right.
They just know that they're guilty
yeah.
and they don't
right.
really know where to take that.
Right.
Well,
for
example, piece of good news I think many people might not know is that in 2013 we had more rides on mass transit than in the history of the country.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
It's the biggest year for mass transit, so the ridership on mass transit is growing. Well, that's an indication of a number of things,
yeah.
but it's good news. And
right.
it indicates, Nancy, I think, that there is, it's not a hopeless idea, that people, I think, we're showing, there's little indicators showing that people are willing to do something
yes.
if they could be part of a bigger effort that will get
right.
something done. Everybody knows that whether I use an aluminum can or
right.
a reusable bag versus a plastic bag, that one plastic bag isn't going to doom the planet. But
right.
if I can be part of eliminating plastic bags on a huge scale, then the
right.
damage to the world's oceans and the wildlife that comes from plastic, as an example,
right.
can
right.
make a difference.
Right.
And that idea of collective action, which is fundamental to the left, I think, project,
yes.
which is to say, because we're not, the two ways to have power in any society is to have enormous resources, which I don't know about you guys, individually, or to work with others.
Right.
Those are the ways you can influence events. So our only hope is to work with others and to get together.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also a message that's pretty hard to get
right.
out
in
an individualistic, wealth-worshipping consumer
right.
society.
Right.
And especially if you see it as individual sacrifice and individual
right.
guilt
right.
to
right.
solve it,
right.
that really
right.
feeds into... not having some collective way of
right.
dealing with
right.
this.
Right.
And we can. I mean, there has been progress on some things. I mean, I think, on pollution, sometimes it's easy to think, oh, it's just gotten worse and worse and worse. But, the Great Lakes and mm-hmm. the Hudson River are way better than they were
yeah.
even when I was a kid.
Yep.
So there are places we can do that. And I think we'll also... we have to think about ways in which we can work on climate change and stop with some of the emissions and also make our lives better at the same time, because there really are those. And I've been thinking about that for a long time, and my threat is that someday I'm going to do a show on some of the things I've been thinking about that increase, reduce climate change and pollution and resource usage and all that. At the same time, it improves our standard of living.
Yeah.
The first most obvious one is the U.S. military.
Mm-hmm.
For the great majority of us, all that military spending does not improve our standard of living. It's a huge expense, it's a huge waste, and it's one of the greatest users of energy and contribution
mm-hmm.
to climate change in the whole world. At the climate change conferences, for instance, all these countries come together. There is one item that is, by agreement, totally off the table. It's not even to be brought up at any climate change conference, and that's the use of energy by the U.S. military,
mm-hmm.
which is huge.
Mm-hmm.
It's greater than the use of energy by most countries,
yeah.
but it's off the table.
Mm-hmm.
And the United States wouldn't come if it were otherwise.
And just to underline what the popular support for what you're saying, polls show 58% of Americans, U.S. Americans, would support substantial reductions in military spending.
Yes. Yeah.
So this is not an outlier position.
No.
To suggest
no,
that we
no.
could cut back spending on that particular area of our economy
right.
and divert those funds to all kinds of things.
Right. Right.
And probably would support reductions in emissions too.
Oh, so absolutely. That's the not just and the resource usage. Pretty much those go together. There's climate change, there's energy use, there's resource consumption, there's pollution, and there's waste and landfill. Yeah. And those tend to go together very much so, that decreasing one tends to decrease the others. So you get a whole range of benefits there for something that would, for the people on this planet as a whole, would greatly increase the their standard of living.
Yeah.
You know, or just not being threatened by drones is probably a good thing. Yeah. And many other uses of the U.S. military, we'd say. Another one would be a shorter work week. You just frankly produce less, consume less, and have a little bit more time. Mm-hmm. It's hard to think what the drawbacks are for most people in this country or around the world of a shorter work week by just simply the amount of energy we'd save, the resources, but building stuff, too much stuff. We build easily twice as much stuff as we did when I was a kid. You know, we don't need all that, and we would be better off without a lot of that, especially with the free time we would give. There's other things, as I say, I'll threaten another show
I would support you creating another show, Dave, because I think that is a huge missing conversation, and,
really
and it looks like the media is not going to get to it.
Right.
So somebody needs to, again, be the media piece of it needs to start happening.
If we're to
start
do
those
something,
conversations.
Right. If we're to do something, we're supposed to recognize our own guilt and our own personal solutions, and that's 99% of what's out there in terms of motivating people, supposedly.
One of the places we can really see collective action at work is in the federal budget, because it's really where we take, the, you know, fundamentally, a government, a state or federal budget is the allocation of resources that are, you know, the cost is shared communally by pretty much everybody, very unequally in this culture, but still, it's a commitment to take, collect resources in a public forum and distribute them. And the months of February and March are, unbeknownst to some people, are the months where federal budgets, for example, the federal budget for fiscal 2015 was just proposed, a version from President Obama came out in early February. It always does, it has to, by law.
Right.
And then the just last week, I think, the Republican version, spearheaded by Paul Ryan, the Wisconsin representative who's the budget wonk in the Republican Party.
Yes, right.
And both of those got quite a bit of coverage. Another budget came out called the Better Off Budget, put out by the Congressional Progressive Caucus. Uh-huh. This is, they put out a budget, they've been kind of in a revival for the last 2, 3, 4 years, and they've been putting out budgets called the, I can't remember the names of the other ones, but this one, the Better Off Budget, what I want to point out, two things. One is that when the Obama budget came out in early February, and I mentioned earlier that one of the things, it sort of trashed the so-called grand bargain. Mm-hmm. It was a little more of a, I wouldn't call it progressive, but it had a little less of a willingness to give up some fundamental principles in terms of entitlements, in terms of social welfare spending. And so it was portrayed widely in the corporate media as a liberal wish list. That was the phrase that was used. It's a wish list. In other words, it's not going to get passed. He's just trying to play to the base. The Paul Ryan budget came out last couple weeks ago, and that was not portrayed as a wish list, although it's also not going to pass. The Congressional Progressive Caucus budget was ignored. Both the Obama budget and the Ryan budget were covered pretty heavily. The Ryan budget's still being covered because it just came out. The Congressional Progressive Caucus budget, the Better Off budget, was completely ignored. I didn't see any references when I looked in my database of major newspapers. Not one. Just anything called the Better Off budget. 51 articles about the Ryan budget just in the last week, and who knows how many about the Obama budget. But what I want to point out, and I want to encourage people to go to a place which I've recommended before on this show and in my newsletter, Nygaard Notes, is a place called the National Priorities Project. If you want to know about the federal budget, that's the place to go, because they have their Budget 101, which is really explains how it works. And one of the things media does not do, not just with budgets, digression here, not just with budgets, but in general, the media tends to report public policy things especially even legislative things, they tend to report them like they report the number of that truck that just hit you. In other words, look what happened yesterday. They passed this, and here's what's going to happen to you now.
Yeah.
The National Priorities Project and other activists tend to start talking about the budget. So we hear more about the budget in October, you know, when it's coming time to pass it. Mm-hmm. The National Priorities Project, of course, it's too late then, for the most part. You know,
the
lobbyists and the insiders have already shaped it, and you can maybe choose a jot or a tittle here or there, but it's all done. The National Priorities Project gets into it in the beginning. They tell you how it works. They tell you the timeline. They give you resources to do it, to understand the budget and how the process works. And the thing they did with these three budgets, they just put out a study, competing visions. President Obama, Representative Paul Ryan, and Congressional Progressive Caucus released budget proposals for 2015. National Priorities Project examines how new budget proposals stack up against what Americans want. So the chart has five columns. The first column is what area? Job creation, for example. Second column is public opinion. What do Americans want? 74% say improving the job situation is a key issue facing the President and Congress this year. And then they tell you what President Obama does, what Paul Ryan budget does, no new funding for job creation, and what the Congressional Progressive Caucus does. And they go right down with issues like job creation, Medicaid, education, SNAP, which used to be called food stamps, tax loopholes, and on and on and on. For each one, it gives the public opinion polling gathered from reputable sources, and then you can say for yourself, well, which budget matches up with best with public wishes? Yeah. Guess which one does.
Yes.
The Congressional Progressive Caucus is just, it's not even close.
Yeah.
So this is the kind of information, and this is, you could say this is liberal or biased or something. On the other hand, if this kind of thing were reported, and as far as I know, this is completely ignored in the media, then you could at least argue with it. And you could say, and it introduces the idea, which the media could and should do, I think, when a proposal comes out, they tend, because of the nature of their sources, which tend to be very powerful insider sources, they tend to report on things that are pragmatic, that might actually pass.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's one way to do it.
Right, yeah.
But another way to do it is this way, which is to say, let's do our best to find out what the American people want, what do they say they want, and who's speaking to that.
Yeah.
And then let people who don't like it argue against public opinion and the proposal. And maybe there is a good argument. Maybe it's maybe the public is deceived, or maybe they're unrealistic. That's fine.
Yeah.
But we don't even get
to talk about it. At least it's discussed, yes.
And that's why I think this is really commendable, and I'm not pushing the National Priorities Project, but I do think they do good work on their Budget 101, understanding the federal budget, and this particular report I think is really helpful for people who want to get in early in the going on and talk to your elected people or just talk to your neighbors about what's happening with the budget, because the budget is, a budget is really where the rubber meets the road. You know, you can say you support X, Y, or Z, but if your budget has $0, like the Ryan budget, you know, says it wants to help with unemployment, but it's the supply side approach where we're going to cut taxes so much that there'll be so much more money to produce more things to hire more people, which has not been shown to work. So
you know that's actually a good opportunity to write a letter to the editor to the paper.
Absolutely,
because that is the kind of thing that a paper will cover in a letter to the editor, and you just raise it, the National Priorities Project, and you describe the exactly how they do it, public opinion versus the different budgets, because it sounds neutral enough. It's just a suggestion of where to go for more information, but it might provide information for people who have never known about that resource.
Yeah. And it's just, you can find it on the web at nationalpriorities.org. So I recommend it. I could read a few more things about the Better Off budget, but I think maybe we'll talk about budgets another time, because I don't want to get started on something at this point in the show, but maybe we have time for one more thing, if I can think of something.
Yeah.
Well, we were going to hear about your propaganda self-defense. Is it too hard to do in a nutshell?
What I'll do is introduce the idea of what I have is a list that I'm about to publish one of these days, which I'm calling Media Propaganda Self-Defense, and they're just concrete tips for people to take as individuals because I always talk about, and I won't go into it other than to describe what it is, because I use an analogy of public health, that the public health approach to propaganda is to try to eliminate the incidence so you don't have to defend yourself against it because your media is actually not producing propaganda, they're producing information. In the meantime, since we still have measles, we can inoculate ourselves, and there's some ways to do that, and that's what I'm offering here. For example, the first one, which I'll talk about more next month, I hope, the Ukraine gives a good example. I encourage people to not use news media to introduce yourself to a subject. So, for example, when a subject like Ukraine comes up, I'm guessing that, like me, most viewers hadn't spent a great deal of time studying Ukraine until about a month and a half ago. Yeah. Or some, maybe in the fall when they were talking about Orange Revolution and things like that. So what do you do? Because I know for people who are interested and want to be informed, it's very, very difficult not to just turn on the news or pick up the paper and say, what's happening in Ukraine? Yeah. What I advise people to do is, I will list them real briefly, if I can find my sheet here, to do four things. One is to choose your starting point outside of the media. Remember that media will ask and answer its own set of questions. Your questions might be different. So the starting point is to acknowledge that corporate media tends to come in with a certain point of view, and you don't want to just start with that point of view. It might be where you want to start, but how would you know unless you first go outside and get the big picture in your head. Find some sources outside of the media that give you a little background, history, context, and start there so you know what questions you want answered.
Or even a map.
A map.
Oh, jeez.
It's unbelievable how important that can be.
They're not very good at putting those in the news stories either.
Well, for example, there was a little bit of reporting on what I mentioned earlier in the show, that the U.S. NATO is planning exercises in Azerbaijan, Armenia, and Moldova. Right. Where are they?
Yeah.
Well, Azerbaijan is right on. I mean, it borders Russia. So for us to, you know, that right. And if you look at a map, it's like, oh, we're going to have exercises right there. Yeah. You know, who's massing troops where here?
Yeah.
You know, so that you're right. A map is one thing, but just get a picture. You know, what are the geopolitics here? Who are the powers? Who are the less powerful? What's the history here? And get some of that not from the newspaper.
Right.
Get it from some trusted sources, and we can talk on another show about how you find trusted sources.
Yeah. Why are people interested in Ukraine other than Ukrainians?
Right.
You know, it's a good thing to know. Yes.
In fact, I want to, we're out of time. I guess I'll talk about it next month.
We're out of time.
Yes, we'll have something left to talk about.
That's our show for today. Thanks for tuning in. You can find us on the web at www.ourworldtodaytv.org.